Can this work? Could SpaceX's Starship destroy the pad during a catch? The second Starship tower is finally complete. The next-gen Starship gets an update, but what is it? And a German rocket has an unfortunate failure. My name is Felix, welcome to What About It? Let's dive right in. Starship updates. We begin today's SpaceX Starship Explainer journey at the launch site. If you want to learn more about what exactly SpaceX is doing here in Texas, keep watching. Many of you probably are aware of this site's job, but let me explain it to those who aren't. This launch site has been used for many tests on Starship prototypes, but now it is almost exclusively used for testing super heavy boosters and launching full-stacked Starships. And in the near future, something extraordinary will happen here. This site accommodates two pads, one still under construction to help increase the amount of launches and boost Starship's capabilities. First, let's look at the operational tower to see SpaceX's progress towards Starship Flight 5. We're actually still determining if that pad is currently operational. Tower 1 was constructed in 2021, has supported 4 launches, and is currently gearing up for its 5th. The problem is that it might not be completely ready. We were thinking that the pad might be nearly ready for the next flight, but recently work has resumed. SpaceX's second largest crane, the LR11000, was soon hooked up to the SQD to repair it. The SQD, or Ship Quick Disconnect, is located on the tower and connects to the Starship upper stage. It provides propellant and power to the second stage right before flight. Kinda important, which is why they need to repair it. Don't worry though, this seemingly was only for last minute repairs after flight 4 and straightening the arm. We've seen an improvement in the SQD on each Starship flight, but no flights have seen it come out in perfect condition. This is a perfect example of SpaceX's iterative design process. Use it and see how it fares, and if it doesn't meet expectations, improve. This is likely something that SpaceX is just waiting to improve when they complete their timely renovation of Tower A. But that will only happen once Tower B is online. For now, they'll probably just repair it each time. But let's not just get hung up on repairs, let's talk about some juicy upgrades. For this one, let's look into another essential component of the launch tower, the chopsticks. They will have a very important role on the next flight. The crazy named, crazy looking arms for grabbing rockets out of the sky. That's the benefit if you're building something that hasn't existed before. You can name it, and SpaceX loves shenanigans. If you've been following Starship recently, you'll know that SpaceX is ready to attempt a booster catch on Flight 5. They've been through all the tests, lift tests, slam tests, and even slab tests, but it seems they still might not be ready. But before I tell you about that, help us improve the channel even further by double checking that you've hit that subscribe button so you don't miss our updates. While you're at it, give us a like and become a Y supporter. Why? Because you'll gain access to a massive amount of extra content. With it, you get access to daily new Starbase photo galleries, including all those we've posted so far. Satellite, aerial, and ground photos, more than 400 posts in the past 2 years alone, with up to 7 picture galleries per week. Insights, chats with me, you name it. Thank you very much from the entire team, you rock. So back to where we were, do the chopsticks need to be stronger? I'm saying this because we recently spotted SpaceX crews reinforce the entire chopstick arms. They installed structural gusset plates around the chopsticks at almost all welds on the beams. The plates are welded onto each side of the weld and secured together, which suggests that the current chopstick design may not be up to par. This is interesting because it suggests that SpaceX is still nervous about this maneuver. That's great, so it's not just us. Or SpaceX is just playing it cautiously, which wouldn't necessarily be in line with past behaviors. Whatever it is for, it certainly gives me a little more faith in the plan to catch the largest rocket ever, but we will just have to see if it improves the design. It's quite a significant upgrade, just not one that's super noticeable to the untrained eye. It'll be interesting to see if they modify the chopsticks for the second tower this way or not. After all, they are almost identical by construction method. Although those chopsticks are much shorter and therefore can hold much more weight. That might just be enough to not have to fix the second pair on Tower B. Speaking of Tower B, let's do a thorough checkup on that. This is important since SpaceX has been moving forward full steam ever since the first module was stacked. It is rare to see a week without a module stacking. Last time it was Module 8 and it wasn't different this time either. Module 9 was just going up when I recorded this episode. It was rolled to the side and it underwent preparations for stacking. The problem is that the crane must be disconnected from the module load spreader to assemble the internal elevator shaft. The Mechazilla elevator is a very important component. The tower is the tallest structure for miles around at roughly 145 meters or 475 feet. Imagine having to climb this via stairs several times per day. This large crane certainly isn't needed for such a small elevator, but it is easier than moving a dedicated crane there. It also has to set down the load spreader for another reason. Because there is a unique load spreader meant just for this one last module. This load spreader is slanted in order to account for the odd center of mass that this final segment has due to its shape. After these things were completed, they were able to proceed. The lift of the final segment was ready to commence. So now the final segment is stacked. SpaceX has reached the final height and now the finishing touches can be implemented. Things like the chopsticks, the chopstick carriage, the upper quick disconnect, and likely lots of plumbing and cable raceways need to be added or finished. Do you think they'll launch something from Tower B this year? Let me know your best guess in the comments. Which flight will be the first to take off from Tower B? Moving on, we look to the west, where we find the second largest structures at Starbase, the Megabase. But that requires us to move to the build site, and what better to use for that than a sleek red helicopter? Did you know you can take a helicopter ride over Starbase and get the same views as in our videos? Visit redlineheli.com/Felix to book your helicopter ride over Starbase with $25 off. Give it a try, it is unforgettable. The smaller bay, also known as the High Bay, currently only accommodates one vehicle, Ship 31. It's been undergoing tiling after Flight 4 called for a complete overhaul of the heat shield, but this past week it has been relatively slow and only a little work has been completed since then. Let's take a look at Mega Bay 2. This building is special because it's currently where they are constructing the first next generation Starship prototype, Ship 33, or S-33 for short. This is the first vehicle to be officially built at this location, as previous vehicles had only come here to receive engines, which can be done virtually anywhere. Well, anywhere so long as you can get your hands on a couple of Raptor engines. Ship 33, the first Block 2 Starship, has had steady progress and only needs its engine section. But the external segments aren't the only thing necessary to make a ship fly. The internal tanks on a Starship are part of the hull. There are simply domes inside, segmenting parts of the fuselage to create the tank space in between. There are no separate tanks. However, one component does need to be manufactured separately for the tanks. The downcomer. Now, what is a downcomer? Every rocket needs at least two main tanks, propellant and oxidizer. And because a rocket is tall and cylindrical, one tank sits atop the other. The bottom tank feeds directly into the engines right beneath it. The top tank, on the other hand, has to have a way to transfer propellant to the engines below. This is usually accomplished through a downcomer, which consists of a pipe that runs through the center of the bottom tank. It's connected to both the engines and the top tank. You probably already know what I'll say next. Ship 33 received its downcomer. What you probably didn't expect is that this downcomer is radically different from anything we've seen before. It appears to have a center pipe. This pipe will transfer propellant to the three center sea-level Raptor engines. The difference is that this new assembly sports three extra pipes along the outside, which appear to be used for transporting propellant to the three vacuum Raptors. This means it's a quadruple downcomer. This change is likely not due to the ship itself, but to the newer Raptor 3 engines that will be outfitted on these Block 2 ships. Because the Raptor 3 eats propellant even quicker than any other Raptor engine developed, it needs an even faster supply of fuel. This change could be to flow more propellant to each individual engine, causing an increase in thrust. It could also be due to some propellant stability issues. However, this hasn't been an issue on ships in the past. It seems like Raptor 3 was just too advanced for even the ship itself, and everything needs an upgrade to accommodate it. Well, I'm all here for that. Starship just keeps getting better and better. Okay, enough of future prototypes. Where's the ship for the upcoming Flight 5? For that, we have to move over to the rocket garden located just outside of this building. Here, Ship 30 is parked and has been receiving minor work and repairs after it finished its retiling and static fire campaigns. It's doubtful that this ship has anything to do with Flight 5's delays, and SpaceX is merely trying to make it as good as possible for flight and re-entry. So that crosses off ships that we have to inspect, but there is another exciting vehicle located here, nicknamed Slappy. I bet you'll remember how I mentioned in the last episode that the B-14.1 test vehicle recently returned to this site after it tested the chopsticks for a super heavy catch. Well, that would seem to be the end of this vehicle, but SpaceX still has some data to extract from it. Our on-site photographer Jordan captured footage of crews inspecting it and assessing the stresses a catch like that would put on a vehicle. If you remember the first time this vehicle was at the pad for testing, you'll recall that it sustained some damage, possibly in the form of cracks. This is likely why it returned at all, as well as to test the second chopstick. Until a full analysis of the tank is finished, SpaceX can't be sure that this time around it didn't get damaged as well. Did you know that there is another odd-looking test tank at Starbase? For that, we have to travel 6 miles to Massey's test site. This is where SpaceX conducts cryo tests, static fires, and sometimes even more destructive tests. The TT-16, or Test Tank 16, was recently moved here after its time in Mega Bay 2. This is the test article's second time at this location, and it's likely for similar purposes. Once it arrived, it was lifted onto the brand new can crusher test stand, likely for more pressure testing. We've speculated that this test tank exists to test technologies that are and will be on the Block 2 ships. It even resembles a section of a ship and has many of the external features. Now, the reason why they brought it back to this site is still a mystery, but we have a couple of ideas. SpaceX is always trying to slim down their vehicles, which can sometimes cause structural weaknesses in the prototypes. You know, if you reduce the material too much. That's why they need to make sure this brand new Starship, which is supposed to be a little lighter than the Block 1 generation of ships, does not give out under aerodynamic pressure. It will also serve as a good test for this new can crusher, as this is the first and only vehicle so far to reside inside it. They need to ensure this contraption works before putting real flight hardware through it. Our next topic has something to do with explosions, and although we all love the occasional unscheduled disassembly, this one is a sad story. RFA, or Rocket Factory Augsburg, is a German startup developing a new rocket known as the RFA One. Yep, we've mentioned it before on the channel. The rocket is a 3-stage rocket, which is relatively rare nowadays. It can take about 3,500 pounds or 1,300 kilograms to low Earth orbit and costs about 3 million per launch. That's why we reported about it before. It is a private company and the deal looks sweet on paper. The vehicle was designed to be built similarly to cars, which Germany seems to be rather good at. This explains RFA One's extremely low price tag. The vehicle has been preparing to fly this year, preceded by a static fire campaign, which was supposed to prove the vehicle's flight readiness. The test took place on August 19th and unfortunately yielded disastrous results. A failure caused flames to shoot out the side of the rocket a few seconds after the test began, which was already a warning sign. This was followed by the entire test stand igniting and the rocket collapsing, causing flames to engulf the entire pad. It's still unclear how much the pad is damaged, but we've seen companies recover from worse. Nonetheless, this is terrible for the company, not only because this was flight hardware meant for the first orbital mission, but also because this was their main launch pad. The question is, why did this horrible event even happen? While almost no official word has been given from RFA, it is possible that this was related to an engine malfunction. The rocket uses the so-called Helix engine, and it has 9 of them. It's a redundancy approach, same as SpaceX's Falcon 9. It might be that an engine exploded and began spewing flames towards the inside of the engine section. This caused the walls of the thrust section to burn through, which caused an evil chain reaction. This would also explain why the whole stand caught on fire, as the rest of the engines also likely failed after one went out. It's quite an unfortunate fate for this first vehicle, but I have no doubt that RFA will get back on its feet and try again. I did get some initial feedback from sources involved in the incident, and a first inspection of the pad revealed minor damage. Good luck, RFA. Lessons learned, onward to the second try. You can do this. Now let's talk about a spacecraft that left Earth but is now returning. The plot twist is that it's not here to stay. JUICE, or the Jupiter Icy Moon Explorer, is a European-designed spacecraft on its way to the largest planet in our solar system, the gas giant Jupiter. It plans to visit the moons of Jupiter in an attempt to further our understanding of our solar system. The problem is that any probe going that far into the solar system will cost a lot. Without powerful enough rockets to carry it and all the propellant it'll need on the trajectory, it's almost impossible to reach the destination. That's why a trend was created back in the 1970s known as gravity assists. It's a neat trick that works by sending the spacecraft on a trajectory that will fly right by a large gravity well, such as our own Earth or Mars. Gravity assists work like a slingshot. As the vehicle gets pulled towards the planet by its gravity, it builds up speed and gets flung off in a different direction. With precise enough calculations, you can string these together to get to the exact location you need to with much less initial velocity. The famous Voyager probes used this and completed a gravity assist with almost every planet in our solar system to get where they are. This is important to understand the JUICE mission. The mission was launched by an Ariane rocket. It's not Ariane 6, but its older sibling, Ariane 5. They made it the first vehicle to fly by the Moon and Earth and to perform a gravity assist around both celestial objects. Its next step will be in 2025, when it makes a flyby of Venus, which will be very similar. After that, it will return two more times to Earth with a three-year gap between them. That will happen in 2026 and 2029, ending its series of flybys and giving it enough velocity to finally reach Jupiter. The final leg of the journey will conclude in 2031, when it finally reaches its destination and begins exploring its icy moons. This initial flyby was quite a special achievement. The EU, where it was built, can be proud of this mission. Its results might change how we look at Jupiter's moons. This special probe will further the exploration of our solar system and is one of very few probes currently attempting this type of research. Well done on your first step of the journey. May the juice be with you. That's it for today. Remember to smash that like button, subscribe for more awesome content. This is what fuels the algorithm and it helps us immensely. Check out our epic shirts in your favorite space nerd store. A link is in the description. And if you want to train your space IQ even further, watch this video next to continue your journey. Thank you very much for watching and I'll see you again in the next episode. We begin today's SpaceX Starship, which suggests, the fuck? Segmenting super heavy catch. Damn. Give me a second, I gotta mute my phone. Earths. How do you even say this? Earths. And bidding.